Well, Josh, it is a pleasure to have you here on the podcast, my friend. Thank you for your time today.
Thanks, Jimmy. Appreciate it.
Yeah, I guess you probably got pretty sick of getting interviewed over the last couple of years. It's been a few years since you had to go through that, but yeah. I mean, how often were you given interviews back during when your dad, Mitt, was running for president?
You know, I was probably doing three or four a week, would be my guess, almost every day, something, somewhere. Some of them really big, some of them really small, but got to do a lot of different things. Was on, you know, CNN with Candy Crowley, which was not a highlight, but I don't know, just had a lot of different things and a lot of fun. I, you know, got to meet Oprah and sit down with Oprah once, and so it's fun. I was on, my mom was on The View, but I was in the audience, and they brought me up and got to talk there. So yeah, you get to do a lot of fun things and interesting things and meet some fun people.
No, I love it. Well, one of the fun things about having you on the podcast, I mean, everybody obviously knows who you are. Your dad ran for president. That's about as big of a spotlight as you can put on somebody, and you guys obviously were part of that. But it is a podcast highlighting exceptional people. And you recently, you and I've gotten to know each other a little bit better, is you bought a mortgage company recently, but you've had this huge history since, I mean, you went to Harvard Business School, and you've been a very, very successful businessman for a long time now. And so it's kind of funny because you kind of get romped in with, you know, with your, call it your last name or your pedigree and everything else. But personally, I've always kind of followed what you do. We have a very close friend, Johnny Jackson, and he's told me so many stories and so much about your business acumen. And that was kind of why I wanted to sit down with you and really dig into kind of what you've personally done, because you had a lot of pressure growing up. I mean, that wasn't like a normal person's childhood, but give us a little bit of background of what that was like, because you know, your grandpa was in the spotlight and then your dad and everything else.
Yeah. You know, my grandfather and my dad have been wildly successful, and in some ways, yeah, it creates a lot of pressure. In some ways, it takes it off because you know you can never meet or exceed what those two have done. And they, you know, they've done so much for me in terms of creating my character and who I am. I mean, I look at my grandfather, who passed away. It's been almost 20 years. And, you know, think about him, if not every day, nearly every day, I think about him in some aspect or another. And so he left me an incredible legacy. And just the life he lived was so extraordinary, and he overcame such incredible things. He was born in Mexico, you know, and had to overcome, you know, abject poverty a couple different times in his life. They moved soon after he was born. They moved to Idaho, and you know, really lived through the Great Depression. Ate potatoes for a year, nothing but potatoes for a year, essentially almost nothing else. And so, later in life, he wouldn't go near a potato.
I can imagine.
There's no way you could cook a potato that would make him interested in it. But to come from that kind of background, to you know, eventually running American Motors and governor of a state, it's just an extraordinary life, an extraordinary example. And then my dad, obviously, you know, he's well known for everything he's done, his incredible business acumen and what he's accomplished in the business side, as well as running the Olympics, being governor of Massachusetts, and then the nominee of the Republican Party. And so you just kind of know that you're never going to be what those two men are, and it's okay. You know, it's like those are extraordinary men, and my life is incredibly blessed for having them in my life and for kind of having them be mentors for me and guide me. And so I don't really feel the pressure that, hey, I got to do what my dad did or be better than him in any way, because it's just not real likely or possible.
Well, and I mean, your dad was always had so much going on. Was your mom more the one that kind of raised you more? Were you closer to her? Were you closer to your dad? Did he find that
he found
time
a lot of
there?
Time. So he found a lot of time to be with the kids. He was, you know, he worked hard, but when he came home, this was in the days before cell phones, and you didn't check your cell phones. You didn't make calls to the office. There's no email. So when he came home, he was home. And so, you know, we had a really good, really great upbringing. Spent a lot of time with both my parents. Obviously my mom was there for more of the day to day stuff. But he was, you know, he still loves, you know, family vacations. And so we took a lot of vacations. We did a lot of things together. We'd almost always drive. Whenever we went somewhere, we'd drive. We'd get in our old, classic, station wagon with the fake wood paneling,
like on vacation.
Oh yeah, like we had that. We get in there, and you know, no one was buckled, and we'd drive 11, 12 hours someplace fun, and spend a week together. So that was my childhood.
Well, and I've talked to our mutual friend Johnny quite a bit, and because he's gone on some family vacations with you guys, and he says Mitt is the most just chill, down to earth guy. And I when the documentary came out on Netflix, I think that was something that really came out of that. Do you feel like maybe like that was did a really good job of portraying better who your dad is? And sometimes he has, you know, he's just seen as this like perfect human to the public or whatever. And sometimes some people hate that. Some people love that. Right. But it was polarizing.
Yeah. I think people have a perception of who my dad is. They've seen, you know, they've seen something or, you know, they heard something or, you know, think one way or another on his politics. So they just assume something. And when you get to know him or you see him, and that's what I think the Mitt movie did really well. It's really given insight to who my dad is. That was done by a filmmaker named Greg Whiteley, who's, who's an incredible filmmaker. He's done some other really neat films, did a New York Doll, which is a really fun one. If you haven't seen it, it's worth seeing. Right now he's doing Last Chance You on Netflix. Mm-hmm. And so just an incredible filmmaker. He spent almost a year with us, you know, not full time, but just kind of coming in and out. And so it is funny. You get to a point where you don't really notice the camera anymore. You don't know you're on TV. And so we were really comfortable around him as my dad was. And so you just got to see a side of my dad that not a lot of people get to see or believe.
Yeah.
They just kind of anticipate, you know, some guy who's made a lot of money, is wealthy, is going to be, you know, kind of snotty and privileged. But no, he's an incredibly down to earth, natural, funny, fun loving dad.
So did you have a lot of like pressure? Did you go to your dad about what you want to do when you were older? Or how did you decide what route you were going to take?
No, I one of my early jobs out at in college was interning for my dad in the private equity company. And he made it pretty clear, like if I wanted a job there, I'd have to earn it. And I wasn't ready for it. So it's like the summer an unpaid summer internship was one thing. And so I kind of knew like, that was going to be a tough road. And I thought about it, and that was something I considered following in his footsteps, but I decided to go my own way. And I think I've really enjoyed kind of forging my own path and doing my own thing. So I went the real estate route, right after college, went and worked for a big group out of Boston, and just had to make my own way, figure out my own thing and didn't have to rely on my dad for connections or anything. Just really had to make it on my own and prove myself. And so that's, you know, I think it would have been hard for me to go work at, you know, at my dad's company and never really know if I made it or if, I was just there for him because of him. And so I just went out on my own and did it. And I think I've been, you know, been really successful and in my own right.
So I think a lot of people, you went a more traditional route. You went to college, then you went to business school, mm-hmm. and then you started building a company, which is kind of that traditional route.
Yeah.
But you did it very successfully. So do you encourage other people to go that route, or what advice do you give to younger people?
Yeah, you know, business school is always a tough one. You know, I think I've made a lot of really good connections in business school, a lot of really good friends that I still keep in touch with, and it's opened a lot of doors in a lot of ways, but most of my education has come from doing bad deals. You know, not every deal I've done has been an A+, and the ones I do where I make a mistake or I do something wrong, that's where I really learn. And so, you know, I look at where I am today versus where I, you know, started in the business 20 years ago. It's, you know, it's the mistakes I've made. It's, you know, doing a deal that was a little too big in August of 2007.
Would go into a little bit of detail on that, will you? Because I think the audience really appreciates hearing. Like, I think people don't understand that you have had huge failures, and how you respond to that, I think, is the story in and of itself.
But. Yeah. So probably the biggest deal, even today, not today, but biggest deal to that point that I'd done. It was a big land deal I did in August 2007. The market was still just booming along. There was no end in sight. And then within 30 days, the market was completely dead and the world was upside down. And I had, it was a land deal that I'd bought with a lot of leverage. And so I was writing the bank a check every month, which was incredibly painful. So a lot of lessons learned there. And I have never bought land since that date with leverage and you couldn't get me to. It's like,
how big of a piece of land was it?
It was, I hate to even say how big it was. It's embarrassingly big. But it was more of a ranch deal. So it was like, it was a big deal.
Yeah. Well, I think if you weren't, cause I was in it at that time, the real estate side. And I think if you weren't in it, you don't understand how it was going. Yeah. Like, I looking back at that time, I always say I'm grateful that I was only 2 years into real estate, because all the realtor friends I knew that were super successful had started going into the land, because that's where the big money was, the flipping land and things, and they all just lost everything, right? Yeah. And so I always say I'm super grateful that I was still fresh enough that I hadn't quite jumped into that yet.
Yeah, and I was at a point, I mean, I was at a point where if I hadn't been able to figure it out, I would have lost everything. Mm-hmm. And I'd worked a long time to build stuff up and it was all going to be gone, but kind of just, you know, had to figure it out. There was no other option than to figure it out. And so we spent a year, you know, repositioning it, working on some things, improving it, and was able to, fortunately, just get out with my and break even, which was a miracle. Yeah. And so to break even, and it was, we bought the land really well. So it was a really good buy. It was a really good deal. It's just timing literally could not have been any worse.
Yeah. August 11th, I always say, was the absolute day that the market crashed. Yeah. So however close you were to that, you said August.
I think we were early August is when we did that.
Yeah, it was like within a week probably.
Yeah, it was as bad a timing as you can imagine. But we were able to get out, and then I was able with the cash that I had to say, all right, am I so scared that I'm just going to kind of sit in the sidelines and wait or see what happens, or do I just keep going? And so we decided to really get after it. And so I made some big deals, made some big investments, and started. That's when I really, I think, made the bulk of my money, was over those next 2 years, was, you know, just buying as much as I could possibly buy.
Yeah, I'd heard that about what you did is right after everything crashed, and you were really aggressive when everybody else was afraid.
Yeah.
So what was that? I mean, what was your quality that you had, or how were you able to do that? Because I remember so many people were paralyzed at that time. What was it that gave you the confidence to do that and make those right decisions?
I didn't have a lot of confidence. I think a lot of it was luck. I mean, I got to be honest. We did not anticipate the market coming back in the way it did. Mm-hmm. I knew I was buying good deals, and I knew we were doing good, we were making some good bets. I absolutely did not anticipate the market coming back in the way it did. And so we thought it'd be a slow recovery. Had I known how fast the recovery would be, I'd have made a lot more money, but we ended up selling. Yeah, we ended up selling. So I'd buy something, I'd sell it 60, 90 days later. And you know, sometimes you double your money, sometimes not quite, sometimes you do better than that. I mean, it was kind of the Wild West, and banks were unloading properties at values that didn't even make sense. It was so cheap.
Yeah.
And so we bought a lot of that stuff. I think, put together a few thousand apartment units of an average price of, you know, less than $15,000 a door. So that was, you know, we just got really lucky, in terms of our timing. So I had a lot of bad luck in timing, and then kind of turned it around and just kept growing. And so we did really well, and then, was able to grow the business and get into a lot of things and do a lot of things that, you know, I couldn't get into now with today's market. I mean, the market today is tough. And we're still doing deals. I'm doing, you know, a few deals here and there, but it's a lot harder to find good
opportunities. Yeah, I think in my own business, we've kind of paralleled that in the sense, I mean, on a much, much smaller scale, but I really dove into getting investors, working with investors. I was, you know, when everybody else was kind of hesitant, I could really sell the vision to investors. I could show them on the affordability index, these are 60% below value right now. And they were. And it really saved my career in that 2010, 11, 12 timeframe. But nowadays, I have probably 100 investor buyers ready to buy the right property. Mm-hmm. The problem now is finding the best deals. It's not, you know, but every market, I think something that you learned is every market either has, it's got its positives and it's got its negatives, right? And so the opportunist or the person that, you know, really puts the effort in to figure out where that opportunity is the person that's going to benefit the most from it.
Yeah.
Well, and recently, I know you know, this is something that we've been talking a little bit more on. You invested in a new company, mm-hmm. a lending company. Tell us a little bit about.
Yes. So about 2 years ago, or a little over 2 years ago, I bought a company, a mortgage company. I saw an opportunity in the Valley. You see a lot of the big lenders. So, I mean, I don't want to go through their names, but there's some big, big lenders in the Valley, and then some really small ones. And so we kind of fit in between that. So I'm a direct, this company was a direct issuer, so it can sell directly to Fannie, Freddie, and Ginnie, which is rare. And it services its own loans. And so we kind of, we fit a little niche that they didn't have in this market. And then we also, and so that allowed us to compete with the small players and compete and win. And then against the big players, a lot of those guys have a hard time adapting to new technologies or innovating. And so we are really forward-thinking in terms of innovation and technology and adopting as much as we can, as fast as we can. And it's expensive to do that up front, but we think in the long run that's what's going to give us a real competitive advantage. And so we're competing with these guys. I mean, at this point, you know, I think we have a much better process than any of those guys do on our back end. Our rates are better. The service is better. And so we're able to compete with the big players now and win.
Well, being in the industry, I obviously keep a big pulse on it. And one of the things that's impressed me the most, what you've done, is just the how quickly you've scaled it here locally, at least. Like how many do you know, like figures as far as how many loan officers you're working with you guys now?
We have about 80 loan officers. As of June of last year, we had zero. So in terms of a retail loan officer in Utah, so we had an office in California. That's where the company was based. And so we had employees there, not a lot, really only about 5 employees left over from the acquisition. But we've added about 200 employees in Utah, 80 of those loan officers. So it's been really good. We're growing really, really fast but at a pace that's allowing us to kind of keep up. So it's been really good.
And you, in your charity side as well, you're involved with a lot of different charity work and things like that. Yeah. Charity Vision is a company that you're the president of, or a charity that you're president of. And same thing, like when I heard the numbers of what you guys were doing, I want you to kind of talk a little bit about that charity, because you guys go in, people that, for those that aren't familiar with the charity, Charity Vision, people that cannot see in these developing countries that are blind, but they have something, that they can basically it can be fixed with the right surgery. And you went in last year alone. How many people did you give sight to?
We did 80,000 surgeries last year and gave away a few hundred thousand pairs of glasses. And so, I'm really passionate about it. It's something that means a lot to me. So there's 20 million people in the world right now that are blind that could see with a simple surgery. And we think about, 20 million people, it's an incredibly big number. And you can imagine, sight is something that if you had any ability to get it back, you would do it.
I can't think of a better gift that you could give an individual than literally giving them sight.
It's really moving. And the actual surgery itself, taking someone in, it's interesting. You typically have to wash their feet first. You clean them for, so you're kind of doing something that's pretty humbling. So you go in and wash your feet. They take them in the operating room. You guide them in because they can't see, and 10 minutes later they come out with vision. It's really incredible, and it's something that costs us about $15. But what gets me most excited about it is the way we're doing it. So we only use local doctors. As much as we love, American doctors and their desire to go over and, do things, the local doctors, they speak the language, they know the culture, and you're building a medical infrastructure instead of disrupting it. So a lot of times when you send an American doctor over, it can be disruptive to a local community, to the medical community in particular. But when you're using a local doctor, you're building that infrastructure. You're putting money back into that into the infrastructure. So it's really, a kind of a 2-for-1 win there. And then not only are we using local doctors, but we're doing it, our cost is about $15 a surgery. So that's pretty cool.
It's like next to nothing.
It's next to nothing. And then what we've done is we've set up these clinics where we will provide all the equipment and supplies, and we pay the doctor a small salary. And they get a bit of the profit of the clinics. And we do about 80% of our clinics are charity cases. So we always have our patient pay something, even if it's just a dollar. We want them to participate in some way in the care. And then 80% are charity cases, and the other 20% are full pay. And so through that model, every time we set up a clinic, they've been profitable within 3 months. They're profitable and self-sustaining. So once it's there, it actually spits off a little money back to the charity. And it can stay there in perpetuity doing surgery. So it's something we're really excited about. It's a really innovative and cool model. And then our overhead at this point, we've done something else that's a little unique. So we used to get all our supplies from a third party, all our big equipment and all that stuff. We started doing it in-house, and we became a vendor for the U.S. government. We're one of the only charities in the world that can do that. And so we get a lot of equipment from the U.S. government that they allow us to sell. And so we're profitable on that point. So profitable, in fact, that we've covered 100% of our overhead. So literally every dollar you give to the charity goes straight to charity work. So we're not paying anyone, not a single dollar. I'm obviously not paid. I volunteer my time. And a lot of others do as well. And so when you give money to the charity, it 100% goes to charitable work. So if you give $15 to the charity, someone's going to get their eyesight back.
That's pretty incredible. Have you had an opportunity to go to some of these countries and see the change when people go in and come out?
So that's, so I take, two or three of my kids every year and we go somewhere. So Indonesia, India, Peru, we're in 25 countries, Philippines. So we're, we travel somewhere every year. I'm going back to the Philippines again this year with a couple of my kids. We have a really neat operation there, a couple of hospitals that we own that we do a lot of surgeries in. So it's really fun. So we're going back this year, get to show my kids, you know, what we're doing over there. And for me, there's nothing more gratifying than seeing someone come out of that operating room with vision. Or the other thing we do a lot of is we screen school kids. And so we go in, do a big screening. And we'll find a big portion of these kids that we realize can't see sometimes 2 or 3 feet in front of their face. And so you'll see these kids that they just tend to be really introverted. They're not social. They're not interacting. They're not learning to read, certainly. And the teachers haven't diagnosed that it's just a vision problem. They think a lot of times they have mental issues. And so we go in, give these kids a pair of glasses that allows them to see the board, and it is really, I mean, that is a moving thing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just instantly you go from essentially being blind, I mean, not really, not literally, but from not being able to see right in front of you to having vision that instant is just incredible.
I can only imagine that happens. I know I got LASIK surgery several years ago, and I went to a college football game as soon as my eyes were good to see, and I could read the names and the numbers on the jerseys for the, and that was like such a small thing because I had glasses. I mean, I could see, but it was, I just remember thinking like, oh my gosh, like that's what it looked like all along. And so just to go from blind to being able to see, pretty awesome. So, well, and then you touch bases a little bit, kind of a really cool opportunity for you to take your kids. You have seven kids, which,
yeah. Oh yeah.
I grew up with, there's seven in my family. Mm-hmm. And so I love it. Just having a big family, there's so many opportunities to, you know, share experiences and love and bonding and things like that. But how do you manage running the charity, running your businesses, and at the same time being a dad to seven kids?
Yeah, I think, you know, you got to prioritize in some ways. So kids always take the highest priority for me. And so I always make sure that, you know, I get home at night and spend as much quality time with the kids as possible. I actually do. I take each of my kids on a little date night, daddy dates, they call them. And so tonight I'm taking one of my kids down to Cabela's. He wants to get something down there. So, you know, I try and spend a lot of individual time with them and a lot of, you know, just really good quality time. When I'm home, I'm home. And there's nothing that's more important to me than those kids, and they know that. And so, they really are my life.
Well, that's awesome. That sounds like kind of, you gave a similar example. That's how your dad was was with you. And obviously his schedule was hectic, as is yours.
Yeah.
So how do you decide what projects to take on? Because you have so much opportunity. You have so much experience, and you've built a situation in your own life where you really get to design kind of what you want to put your time and focus on. How do you make those decisions of where you want to put your effort?
It's really, you know, it's one of those things. I get presented a lot of deals and I see a lot of deals. And it's things that, just get me excited. Things that I'm passionate about, things I care about. So on the real estate side, I love the creativity. I like thinking outside the box and seeing, finding a problem that, you know, other people don't see a solution to and coming up with that solution, you know, whether you, changing use or, you know, just finding a way to get things entitled that other people can't and just kind of finding solutions that other people can't see. So I love that creativity side. And the mortgage side, it's fun to put people in homes. We think of all the homes we're putting people into. That's a really fun thing for me. And then the people you work with. So we put together a team on the mortgage side is just a group of people that are really fun to work with, that you want to be around, that you like spending time with. So from our loan officers up to our C-level employees, these are really fun people. And so I love going to work. I love spending time with them and just being able to interact. So it's you know, what brings you, you know, happiness and is fulfilling, and is using your talents in some way. So I feel like, you know, on the real estate side, I'm really good at it. The mortgage side has been fun to assemble a really fun team.
Well, and I bet for you it's probably a nice change because you put so much time, effort, focus into the campaign, both in, I guess it was 2010 and 2014. Mm-hmm. Give us a little bit, like, I think people are curious. I know I am curious of what is it like when your dad is in the spotlight? You always have people defending him, but yet then you have people looking at your dad like, you know, is this huge celebrity? And to you, he's just dad.
Yeah.
Put us in Josh's shoes a little bit. What were those times like? Did you really enjoy it or was it hard?
A little of both. So, I mean, one of the things that's, I think, most interesting is people make really quick snap judgments about, you know, who my dad is. And it's funny, you'd read, the biggest mistake and the thing I'd recommend anyone is never to read the comment section on an article, because there'd be an article written, I'd be like, I'm just curious what people think. And it's like, oh my gosh. I mean, just some of the most offensive things that are said. And you just realize, you know, at first it's just like, you just can't even believe it, right? And it makes you sick. And you're like, and then you realize these are people who have no clue. I mean, that think they're some of the most brilliant people and analysts that, you know, oh, they know exactly what my dad is thinking and why he did what he did. It's like, well, these people have never met him, have never spent, you know, any time with him, or don't know what's in his heart, but they're are letting the world know what's in his heart, right? And so so that's, you realize that these are people with very little going on in their own lives and just don't worry about it, right? And there's a lot of those people that that think they know much more about you than you know yourself. And it's like, you just really can't pay attention to those people. You just don't give them your time and don't let them bother you. And so once you get to that point, once you realize it's like, hey, you're doing this for yourself and for others. And you're, you know, for my dad, I look at him, it's like, he's providing a really incredible service, right? He could be doing a lot of things with his life. He could be making a lot more money in the private sector if he wanted to. But he thinks it's important to give back, and he loves, finding solutions to big problems and loves working with other people and bringing both sides together to find common solutions and common ground and moving forward on big issues that have an impact on people's lives. And so I know that about my dad. So what these people say on these message boards, you know, it's like, who cares?
Yeah.
And so you get to that point, you get a really thick skin, and that, but it took a long time to develop.
Well,
that.
I know you guys, you got spoofed on Saturday Night Live. Oh, yeah, that was good. In the TV show New Girl and a few other things that like stuff. That. Did that make you laugh or was?
Oh, I love that. That was awesome. And there's like, yeah. And I hesitate to even mention it because everyone's going to go look, but there's a meme that got some traction. I was at a debate between my dad and Obama, and I pretty much naturally have a pretty severe case of RBF. I don't know.
What? Gotcha. Yeah.
Yeah. RBF.
Resting face.
Resting, yeah. So I got a pretty naturally good case of that. And so the debate was going on, and Obama was kind of saying some stuff I didn't agree with. And so my face was probably not, it was definitely pretty bad. So they have a screenshot of me, like, and it's like, you can just see my face. And I look like the devil. I'm just so mad. And so that got a lot of traction on the internet. And they made, it's actually really, there's some really creative, funny spins on that. And so it's funny. So some of my friends still occasionally bring that up and laugh at me about that. And it's pretty good.
That's pretty funny. So good. Talk to us. I mean, I know it's in the documentary on Netflix, but what, I mean, just, from the heart, what was that day like when you found out that Obama had won the election?
That was tough. I mean, that was a tough night. We thought we had a really good shot. Obviously, we weren't anticipating a sure victory by any means, but we thought we had a good shot. Got really close and didn't pull it off. And that night, it's just, I mean, you feel sick. I mean, you kind of feel like you've worked so hard and so many people are depending on you. And you've let a lot of people down. I just remember, you know, one of the hardest things is just walking into the hotel room and the Secret Service agents were lined up along the hallway, and a couple of them were like sobbing. I don't mean like, oh, there's a tear in their eye. They were just heavy sobbing. And so that was just, you know, you realize just the gravity of, you know, that election and what it means to the future of the country. And so it's tough. It was a really tough loss. It's, you know, that night, like, is just, like, it's one of the lows of all lows. I mean, it's really tough. I mean, it really is, like, you can kind of compare it to death in some ways when you lose an election like that. I mean, obviously, it's not the same. But in some ways, you kind of go through that grieving process in a similar way. Yeah. And you get over it. I mean, that's the funny thing.
I was going to ask, like, how long did it take you to kind of get over it?
It takes a few months. I mean, maybe a year until you're totally over it. But, like, a few months, you're kind of beyond it. Like I couldn't listen to Obama on the on the radio or TV for a while.
It's like when your team loses out of the playoffs, you're like, I'm not watching the rest of the playoffs.
Yeah, you're done with it. But then time goes on and it's like I can, have really no hard feelings towards anyone. It's like it was a tough race, but Obama ran it the way, he thought he had to run it, and it's you have really get over it. I mean it's like so you move past it and so we feel, I mean, obviously at this point, no feeling at all.
For sure. What did you learn the most from the whole experience? Because it's such an intense experience that most people would never even come close to being able to experience something like that.
Yeah, I got to travel. I traveled to nearly every state through that process. I've been to every county in Iowa, but there's 99, so it's a lot of counties. So campaigned really hard, met a ton of people. There's some really incredible people in the country. Just some really fun people that just absolutely love this country, will volunteer and spend a lot of countless hours working for it to try and improve it. And then there's a lot of people that just have a lot of anger and hate. I mean, it's really interesting. So you kind of see, you see all sides. And I think even today, you look at politics and it's really divided and there's a lot of hate, a lot more than I think there's ever been before in this country.
Yeah.
And I think that's troubling. And I think, we need to understand that just because someone holds a different political view doesn't make them evil, doesn't always even make them wrong. I mean, sometimes, the best solution is somewhere in the middle, and the solution you think is best, if it were fully implemented, wouldn't be very successful. And so, the other side, I think the point of view is important to take in, at least, hear their side and understand it, understand why they're passionate. I think there's kind of a perception now that, if you're not on my side, that you're in favor of ruining the country. And, it's like everyone wants the country to be better, right? Everyone wants to help the poor. Everyone wants everyone to have health care. Like we want people to be healthy and strong, and we want people to come out of poverty. Everyone wants that. And we just have different ways to get there. And we all want a safe country. We all want, anyway, so you can kind of go through all the items. The end goal is the same. It's just how do we get there? And so, recognizing that, that the other side is not evil, I think is an important step. And I think a lot of people don't realize that.
Is there true animosity towards the other candidates and towards the other political party, or is it more friendly? Cause it's such a small circle, that political hierarchy, I guess.
Yeah. I think when you're running it, there's some things that are said that are really personal, some personal attacks. So I think the animosity can grow when you really, when you're kind of going through it, it's like, oh, we're going to, and then the other side starts throwing grenades at you and you're like, what is this?
Yeah. I don't know how they get over it so fast. I would never be able to turn around and endorse the other guy.
So for me, I hold grudges, especially like not so much for me, but for my dad, there's a few people that have said things. It's like, I hold a grudge and it's hard for me to let go.
Yeah.
For me, I can let go of it. No, like I don't mind when someone says something about me, and my dad is really good at letting go. I remember soon after he'd lost to McCain, this was in 2008, he was down campaigning for him. And so McCain had won the primary, and he's like, I'm going down to campaign for John McCain. I was like, what? Heck, you can't go campaign for him. And he's like, no, he's got to win. He has to win. And so he went down and campaigned for him, threw support behind him, gave him money. And it was like, for me, I was like, no, I'm still mad at this guy. And it took a little while. And then I obviously got over it. And John McCain is, an American hero and, would have been a fantastic president. I had taken some things he said personally and didn't get over it quite as quickly as my dad did.
Yeah.
And he was right. And, even after he lost to Obama, my dad went in the Oval Office and sat down with him for a couple hours and talked through some of his, things that he was passionate about. So he's really good at, being just getting over, any personal attacks or vitriol and trying to get the job done. So
what was your favorite day? Do you have a moment or a day that was just your best day during the whole campaign process?
During the campaign? I think one of the coolest things was standing on the stage in Fort Lauderdale when my dad had just been awarded the nomination, and you have, I don't know how many, 50,000 screaming people are just, and there's a balloon drop and just that energy and excitement, and just feeling, a common goal to win an election with that many people was really cool. That was a really fun event.
I bet. And you're the middle child.
I have two older brothers, two younger brothers.
But you were kind of more the spokesman, I would say, of the brothers. It felt like, at least to an outsider.
I like to say so, but they would disagree with that.
Was that because, I know your mom a couple years ago said that you might have ambitions to row. Is that in your plans? Do you feel like that would be something you would want to do, having gone through that process and seeing it so close?
I've kicked it around. I focused on my business and my family, and that's for me most important right now. But I do think it's important to give back in some ways. And so, you know, I'm always gonna think about, you know, about that side and what I could possibly do. Just having my grandfather and father set that example, it's one that naturally just comes to mind. But, you know, having said that, I'm going to make sure the timing is right and that I can really dedicate my time to helping, you know, people that I'd serve. But I'm definitely taking a look at that stuff. But in terms of, you know, on the campaign, I really just had, I put my business on hold for, you know, a year at a time when I'd go campaign for them. I was obviously still doing things and had employees back here working. But I dedicated my time really to go help my dad. And right. So I just was on the campaign trail, I think, more than any of my brothers. So I got a lot of experience. I got to do a lot of interviews. And it's one of those things, the more you do, the better you get. And the fewer stupid things you say. So they trusted me to go out and do a lot of interviews.
Who was your, because you got to meet so many cool people, so many amazing, inspirational people. Who was your favorite person that you met and why?
Let me think. I honestly think Oprah was the coolest. Oh. I mean, she is... much more conservative, I think, than people give her credit for. She's an incredible business person, really engaging. I mean, she's a really engaging person to meet. Similar to, you know, even though I couldn't disagree with this person more politically, it was pretty fun to meet Bill Clinton, who is also just has that engaging personality where, you know, he's hangs on your every word, and you just feel like, man, this guy really likes me, you know, and everyone comes away with that same feeling.
Wow, so Bill Clinton was, that's...
Yeah, I mean, he was not like a hero by any stretch of the imagination,
no,
but someone I look up to, but it was someone that you meet that's like, oh, that's a really, you know, it's a really dynamic, interesting person.
You kind of said this earlier, but I think the fact that you can appreciate and take that away from that, because I say the same things, like, I didn't agree with a lot of what Obama did as president, but if you're not learning from him... then wake up. You need to pay attention. The guy was doing a lot of things that you could learn from. I mean, from his speaking ability, the way he engages a crowd, the way he gets people to believe in a message and a hope and everything else he was doing. Like, same thing with Bill Clinton, that charisma. And like you said, you took away from him that engagement where you felt like you were close friends from him. And I think that's something that people lose. It's like, even with Trump, whether you agree with him or not, if you're not learning some of the branding things he does, some of the marketing things he does, for if nothing else, take away from each person what you can respect and what's got them in the position they're in today.
Yeah. And it's, you know, there's people you can disagree with and on almost every issue and still take something from them. Yeah. So
if, I mean, being, you know, here in Utah and being in politics and everything else, what's one thing that you're passionate about that you would like to, see, take a different angle here in Utah, I guess.
I think education is one of those areas where, you know, we're basically educating our kids for a 1950s economy.
So
you know, from even down to, you know, taking our summers off, the entire summer, where kids, you know, it's unfortunate, but the wealthier kids tend to have more opportunity in the summers to continue to read and stay up on their education, where some of the other kids don't have those opportunities. They tend to fall further behind during those summer months. I mean, just little things like that. But the education, our education system is really, really antiquated. Mm. And so to take a look and not compare ourselves to, you know, to New York or California or, you know, Wyoming, but to say, hey, globally, how can Utah be an absolute global leader on the education front where we're educating our kids for the future, for a future economy, for things that will move them forward in a way that that other states aren't doing. And so I think we can be a real leader there. I also don't think that's a very expensive thing. I think technology, you know, and different, you know, different avenues like that can really provide opportunities that don't cost a lot of money. I mean, for almost nothing, I mean, for a negligible cost, you could have every high school senior educated by a Harvard Business School professor every day. I mean, that would be, it would, you know, with technology now, you could do that. They'd spend an hour and you could even pay them a full salary to do that, the professor. And it really would be negligible when you spread it across, you know, all these kids. So it's, or you could have, you know, Elon Musk, you know, spend an hour. And that's something that, you know, I feel like I could go out and recruit those guys to say, hey, I want you to teach my kids something about innovation or something about technology or, you know, whatever field they happen to be in. It's like, I want you to teach every high school senior in Utah and spend 1 hour a month or whatever it is. And so I just feel like there's a real opportunity and we're missing it. And I'd love to just move forward on that and just say, hey, let's break the mold. Let's not worry about, you know, what are we spending per pupil? Because we're never going to catch up, you know, with some of these other states. But let's find a way to use the advantages we have, you know, the volunteer hours we have, to just say, hey, let's break the mold, let's break out of it, let's do some things that, you know, there's been a lot of studies done about what's important in kids' education and what's not important. And a lot of things we focus on are things that sound good, but actually aren't that effective.
Well, I love that you said that answer. I had an experience. I'll just tell this story real quick because it made me think of this. But I taught a class at the UVU Business School last semester, and I just wanted to do it for fun. I mean, you get paid $300 every 2 weeks. There was no money in it as far as being a professor. It was what was interesting to me, they gave me the curriculum. They gave me all these handouts. They gave me the books. They said, you have to use 90% of this from the book. Here's the quizzes. Here's the tests. And I was like, I'm not going to do that. I don't care if they fire me. I'm just going to do this for one semester, but I'm going to do it my way. And so like the day that we had to have, it was speaking on job interviews. Mm-hmm. Instead of reading it from the book and having this like quiz on it, I brought my buddy in, Ryan Grover. He was on a previous episode of this. He just sold his company. He's interviewed over 500 people in his career. Yeah. And he taught them. It's kind of like a Harvard education type thing, right? Yeah. And at the end of the semester, I didn't know how to put their grades in. I was using my own system, and the director of the program was so mad at me that I hadn't been doing it their way.
Yeah.
And I just was like, look, quiz or test the kids, whatever, give them a survey and see if they enjoyed it or whatever. And, you know, they ended up getting those scores back that they give to each class. And then they asked me if I wanted to teach two more classes, and I was like, I'm good. But it's like the idea of like that traditional education, you know, sometimes of just sitting there and reading it from a book or whatever else. Anyway, so I appreciate, that answer.
And I think in particular, I think every kid learns a little differently and needs different things and should focus in different areas. And we're just, you know, we have a box that everyone has to fit in. Yeah. And some kids don't fit. And you look at, you know, some of the most successful people we have in this country didn't fit that box, dropped out of high school, dropped out of college, you know, just didn't fit that box, but are brilliant people. It's like, how do we...
tap into that.
How do we find the kids who are not able to kind of be successful in that, right, but are still intelligent, just not, they're failing out of school. How do we help them be more successful in their own lives? And, you know, I have a son with dyslexia and he doesn't fit the mold. I mean, he just doesn't fit, but he's brilliant in his own right. And so you just have, you know, it's, and obviously, you know, we've found ways to accommodate and he's excelling in a lot of areas, but you know, how do we really cater to the kid that gets missed, that's flunking out of school, but is a brilliant kid, that we can really cater, that we can find a way to bring him in the system, or him or her.
Oh, I love that. Well, selfishly, I kind of want to know what a day of your schedule looks like and what you do to stay sharp, because I follow you and I've known you for a while, and just what you do and how you get so much accomplished in a day. I kind of want to know any kind of life hacks or things that you do to do that.
I got no hacks. I've learned not to need to sleep a lot. So I wake up mornings 5 or 5:30, go to the gym for an hour to an hour and a half, and just kind of, it's a good place to think and just relax. And it's the only time in my day when I don't, you know, I don't have to do anything. I'm just on my own and get to do my own thing. And so that's nice. And then get ready for work. And I split my time between real estate, mortgage. I'm a scout master, which is fun. So I got scout camp in a couple of days. So I've been gearing up for that and getting ready for camp for a week. But, so it's just, you know, it's just kind of constantly staying busy. My calendar is full every day, but I love it that way. I don't like being bored. I don't like having nothing to do. So I love being busy and keeping active.
There's an old saying, if you want to get something done, give it to the busiest person you know.
Yeah.
I kind of believe that. Yeah. There's just an art to just, I like being busy too. And some people are always like, I don't understand how you did all that. It's like, well, I can give a pretty full day, 16, 18 hours in a day, if I'm staying busy and doing different things, right?
Although I will say, I try and focus on one thing at a time. So, you know, I think that, you know, the multitasking doesn't work for me. Like, I have a hard time going back and forth. So I'll focus on real estate for 2 hours. And it's like, I can't even think about mortgage. And it doesn't, you know, it doesn't cross my mind. Then I switch and it's like, I can't even think about real estate. And so I really kind of focus on one thing at a time. Right. And I think that's worked well for me.
I think that's smart. Well, thanks so much, man. It's been a fun interview. Real quick, the name of your mortgage company for those that
Intercap Lending. Intercap Lending.
And where are you guys located here in Utah?
We have offices all up and down the Wasatch Front. We're opening one in St. George. We're in California. We're in 44 states, so we're kind of all over the place, but all up and down the Wasatch Front. But intercaplending.com.
Yeah, I love it. Well, thanks so much, man.
Okay, appreciate it.
Excited to see what's next for you.
Yeah, thanks, man. Josh.